national president of ABVP, and he will be giving talk on national medical bill. Professor Dr. Sivaiya hails from Thoothukudi district in Tamil Nadu. Right from student life, he has been active in student movement. Noted cancer specialist, Dr. Sivaiya has done MBBS and further masters in surgical oncology, and is presently working as a professor and HOD of Department of Surgical Oncology and at Kilpok Medical College, Chennai. He has performed more than 1,000 surgeries and published 27 medical papers in national and international journals. He has mentored around 40 students in super specialty of surgical oncology. He is member of many association of surgical oncology at national level. His inclination for serving society is true to you for your student age, true to you from your student age, and had been deep interest for development of education and history of Tamil Nadu. He has served in many responsibilities in ABVP since 1986. He has been vice president of ABVP Tamil Nadu and vice president of national vice president of ABVP till 2015. And he has been elected as national president for this 2017-2018 ABVP. Now I welcome Dr. Sivaiya to give his.
आ गया सत्य
सर, गर्मी है
तो गर्मी है। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई विल क्लैरिफाई, आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू गिव एनी न्यू बिग इनोवेटिव लेक्चर ऑन द सब्जेक्ट विच दे सेड। आई विल शेयर some of my experience and the present scenario of this country and my idea, not ABVP idea or not the official capacity, my idea about what can be the future of this country. To begin with, I feel I am angrezi chalchata ko topic us tarah hai. I feel I am qualified a little bit to delve on this subject because from 1990 to 1995 I have worked in rural areas. Rural areas means in one area I should go by walk 3 kilometers morning and return 3 kilometers evening. Secondly, I have resided in all those years. Fortunately, I was not married, so I resided where I was posted. Third thing, I have been transferred every year to different places across Tamil Nadu. And after that, I did my MS in surgery, worked as assistant professor, and I did MCH in oncology, and now I am HOD. And nowadays I see doctors are people who come directly to medical colleges. Like they will finish MBBS, immediately they will sit and study, get their PG degree, then immediately they will sit and study and get MCH. And I am having 4 students per year, 3 years. That is my academic. Since I had some knowledge and background about the two extremes, one is rural, underprivileged area, and urban where I am sitting, now I am more comfortable. I am having an associate professor, 4 assistant professors, and 12 people who are qualified already with MS degree with me to work. So it is a luxury. Both ends I have been there. So I thought I can share few useful things to you. Except sir, anyone from medical field who have basic medical degree or allied degree?
Research.
You are research. You are research.
Yeah, we are doing research in clinical and preclinical.
Okay. Your degree is?
PhD.
PhD. Other sir?
Law student.
Law student. Okay, I am saved. You may not know many things, but I can say. So first of all, I will let you know, any society or any country to be successful should be having a pride in the existing system, whether false or true. Even Nazi Hitler, they had pride in killing Nazi, you Jews. I don't justify that. Even Mao Zedong, he had pride and some aim, and he was expecting some results through Cultural Revolution. Unfortunately, 35 lakh people died. That is a different thing. So my first point is, any country or any society to excel with should believe that what they are doing is correct and should have some pride on their system. Unfortunately, that is a big lacuna in our country. We don't have pride about ourselves as an individual. We don't have pride about our family, except few cases. And we don't have pride about our own country to work here. We always able to go to some better place and work there. So that is the biggest disadvantage. And we don't have pride in our system also. Today I read a news article in the Hindu newspaper in Chennai edition. I don't know whether it came here or not. This Lancet Medical Journal, that's a very reputed journal, that has come out with an article saying that there was a very big pan-endemic disease in 1980 of this H1N1-like virus, influenza virus, that killed crores of people worldwide, and even in India, which was enslaved to British, 1.7 crore people were killed because of the disease. And that time, the medical fraternity of the entire world was not prepared, was not capable of managing that. And the Lancet says, after 100 years, it is now 2018, we are in the same situation in throughout the world. That's a big, big surprise to all of us. But it is not seen outside. We have made many strides in technology development and other development. But so far, we were believing that we have controlled or we have a solution for only one thing, bacterial diseases. Diseases are caused by many organisms, virus, bacteria, autoimmune, genetic, this and that. And we have, right now, if you want to believe, we have a solution in allopathy system only for bacterial infections like tuberculosis, leprosy, or bacterial pharyngitis. All other things, we just provide supportive care. This I am informing you because many of us may think this country was a country of snake charmers, this country was a country of illiterate people, this country had nothing to have credit. And only after the arrival of British and Westerners and modern education, this country has become a better country. It's not so. I am quoting example of a book called An Era of Darkness, written by Shashi Tharoor. He is not a BJP man or he is not a ABP man. He doesn't belong to any organization of RSS school of thought. He is not from Think India also. You please go and read that book. He is our former minister. I think he is an IFS officer, Indian Foreign Service officer. He was, I don't know, I'm not sure. So, his own statistics says that out of entire world's GDP in the first century after Jesus Christ, the India share was 33% of total world GDP. And at the time in 1700, when Aurangzeb was Mughal emperor of this country, it was 23%. How they calculated? Aurangzeb's per annum tax collection was 400 billion pounds. Those time earning 1 pound per week was considered to be a wealthy man. By that way they have calculated GDP. Now you know we are not going to talk about it. So it doesn't mean we were a country of illiterate. If you want, I can quote a quotation. Alan Tanzelman, it may not be relevant here. So, but as far as health system is concerned, we don't know anything about the structure or policy existing in this country in health sector before arrival of British. If you want to write an article, forget about Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, I am not talking about that. I am not talking about system. I am talking about the infrastructure, the government policies guiding the field. If you are asked to write, I think both of you elderly people should enlighten me. As far as I know, there is nothing. It doesn't mean nothing was existing. Because when GDP was 33%, the health indices should have been very high. Do you think a country ridden with diseases, people are suffering from all kinds of illness, high infant mortality rate, maternal mortality rate and maternal diseases will be having GDP of 33% of entire world? It is impossible. GDP is a surrogate marker for your health of this society. Do you understand or not? It's a surrogate marker. It may not be a direct marker. And I will tell you, most of the Western surgical technique, they were developed in India. For example, in 2004, Annals of Plastic Surgery, it is a journal published in West on plastic surgery. It very clearly says that those days, chopping of the nose is the famous punishment. Even Shurpanakha had that. Okay. So that was a very famous punishment for any immorality or criminal activity, anything. Or during war also. But because of that or not, we don't know. The plastic surgical reconstruction of nose using lateral cheek flap or forehead flap, it was excellently described by Sushruta. And from it was being practiced to such an extent that they were saying in between two wars they will conduct that number of surgeries so that when the enemy comes from outside comes again, whatever nose he has cut earlier would have been there. Thousands of noses they have reconstructed. And that technique was learned from India by Arabs. Most of the things are learned, they are in direct neighbors of ours. So they have learned from us. And during Abbasid Caliph Harun al-Rashid, he asked his people to write some treatises book on this technique and Indian medicine, and which was learned by the Westerners, Europeans. And it was, they started to practice that in a huge way in the 18th century. This is one example I am giving. So plastic surgical reconstruction is cosmetic reconstruction is the ultimate surgery. Even insurance companies don't support that. They consider it as a luxury. So when your surgery, which is considered luxury, was that much refined, I hope all other surgeries would have been very much refined in a very big way in this country. But for that matter, I don't justify going back also. You cannot place your bullocks, you cannot place your cart in front of your bullock. Now there is no other way. You can't go back on all of a sudden, even if you convince our present Prime Minister to do away the entire allopathy system and go back to Ayurveda, it is going to be a catastrophe. Because for the past 600 years, nothing, no research and development activity or patronage from the government has happened to that field. And none of the Ayurveda doctors here, even though Sushruta Samhita describes about this much of surgical procedures, none of the Ayurveda doctors are capable of doing surgery now. So there is no need to go back. And coming to what made the present system, what was the initiation for the present system, I will tell you. British came, they came with some people. To start with, it was 5,000, 6,000, total 30,000 Britishers. Among that, 5,000 were armed people. At any point of time, even during the peak of their rule, totally some 1.2 lakh Britishers were there. Among them, some 60,000, 70,000 were with arms. Even there, they were in cantonments. That developed the idea of this Chavani and cantonment in India, I think. They live separate. Even now, the army cantonment is separate. I don't know whether in ancient India, ancient Bharat, the army was in cantonments and it was not allowed to mingle with population. I don't know. But I hope, since the British don't want to mingle for their own reasons, the main reasons help. Because it is new to them. The pre-existing diseases, they never had immunity. If they are allowed to mingle with these people, they will die of diseases, not because of war. They cannot sustain their army. The casualty because of disease will be so huge, you will be defeated. So they started to have their army of their own population to live in groups, clusters, in cantonments. And when they had epidemics of some diseases, they started this practice of preventive medicine. Don't think it. Railway was not built for India's purpose. It was built to transport raw material to ports and transport the manufactured things to interiors, just for. So in that same way, the public health system of this country also was developed not for the benefit of common man of this country. They never bothered. Only 3% of population had toilets in this country when British left. That doesn't mean in the zenith of our period, during ancient Rajaraja Chola, Rashtravardhana or Ashoka, people were openly defecating. That doesn't mean. And we have the finest architecture and management of waterways and drainage system, which was excavated in Mohenjo-daro, Harappa and other Indus Valley civilization. So definitely there will be some system, but when they left, only 3% household, probably that were clustered around the cantonments, I feel. They immunized the people for smallpox. They will not immunize 500 kilometers away. They will immunize around the cantonments, because smallpox should not affect their army. They will take cholera control measures in the vicinity of cantonments. So in that way, public health system developed in this country. Now you know, the child is defective by birth. Do you think any child, it is unlikely that any child that is born with some major defect will be performing or competing equal to others? Probably that is why we are underperforming. And by health indices, in the entire community of nations, our rank is 115. health indices. So pathetic. Okay. So with this background, we will move further. So when in British era, they started this modern immunization and all these techniques, there were no human resources. There were none with MBBS degree, the allopathic medicine degree, nothing. But they had the entire country under them. So haphazardly, and they can't afford to, their main, when East India Company came here, their main purpose was not to uplift the society, their purpose was business. And rightly Swami Vivekananda says, the creed of British were after commerce. And the French, you know, they enjoy everything. And the Greeks, Greek people, they are after arts and like that. Each country has its own inherent nature in their blood. British had commerce in their blood. And even among British, those who were very eager to earn money, they came to this country in the name of East India Company. So at no point of time, they were ready to do some good for this country. So whatever human resources in public health or whatever medical field they want, they tried to, they never had belief in this country, or the inherent innate system of this country, they never had belief. What was existing here, I don't know. We can't say all people here were fools and idiots. Because literature was that much fine here. Fine arts were that much fine here. We have all sorts of very nice things. Architecture. So, no country can afford to have all these things when it is driven by war or diseases. There are this architecture and fine arts and Bharatanatyam, whatever it is, in a refined manner, it is also a surrogate marker for the healthy society. No society suffering from diseases, no society suffering from illiteracy, no society suffering from poverty, no society full of beggars and snake charmers can have Bharatanatyam, can have a very big temple built, can have Taj Mahal built. The nicest of things, diamond, they can't afford. There are surrogate markers for the healthy infrastructure in every field existing in this country, including health field, but unfortunately, East India Company didn't have any belief and knowledge about the existing system. So, they tried to overturn everything. They wanted to, on one day, they wanted to dump everything out. They de-wagonized everything. They wanted to create another big infrastructure requiring thousands of qualified people. Doctors, nurses, in a single day. And their motivation was not to educate this population. They never invested in this. They never allowed our people to go to the country and learn things there. They were afraid. So with this handicap, our health system was born. And since it required a huge population, but the people going for that education and graduating were very less in number, naturally a sense of arrogance, a sense of superiority complex, a sense of isolatedness crept into the society of people educated in health. Even 2 days, 3 days back, I was commenting to our doctor colleagues in Hyderabad. See, our doctors are ignorant, they don't know anything about outside their field, and equally arrogant. They think that they know everything. That's a big problem. So it is also inherent deficiency created because of circumstances. Man is not defective. It is a system that has made the man like this. So no medical graduate is ready to go to villages. they're all cream of society. Their own classmates earn lakhs of rupees. For information, I have two children and one is daughter, she finished her engineering. She refused to become a doctor. Okay. And she got posting, she finished engineering and she got posting in Google. At the age of 21, 22, and she is now transferred to US. Her earnings is on par with mine at the age of 50. So now you understand how the doctors will behave with you. An engineering graduate of 22 years, who did it? My daughter, most of the engineering graduates till 10 years back, they were doing engineering because they didn't get a medicine seat. In my own class, my classmates who were not as meritorious as like me, they didn't get MBBS, they opted for engineering. Whenever I look at them, I will stand on a high pedestal and look at them down. And when they yearn, how will they agree, observe? The human tendency is to improve my earnings. So now all sorts of nasty things are happening here. I don't want to elaborate because most of you are lawyers, and to teach you again in all these things will be a big problem for my profession in future. Okay. And you won't agree or accept your own fields deficiencies. That is different kind of thing. He is to say, in each system of this country is suffering like this. A honest lawyer or judge also will talk like me only. I think, I hope so. So, unfortunately, our own man, Babsi Reddy, he is the culprit who first made this profession as an industry. Now, medicine is an industry, it is an industry. In industry, only money speaks. For one month, I am allowed to do private practice. After 2 o'clock, my health secretary says you can earn crores of rupees, we don't bother. We are not getting any non-practicing allowance. So in that corporate hospital, at the end of the 1 month, they gave me a statement. Sir, 4 surgical oncologists are practicing here. You are the senior most. Your total income this month is 20 lakhs. The other person's total income is more than you. Then I went, I have operated, I don't stick on to one hospital because I give options to patients. If they are poor, I ask them to come to government hospital. If they are rich, I ask them to come to corporate. And my surgery will be same anywhere. It is not different in corporate and it is not different in government hospital. Man is human, is human being everywhere. The treatment should be accordingly same everywhere. When I saw that doctor's patient has developed a complication, he was in ICU for 10 days and a single patient has spent about 15 lakhs. But the hospital is happy. At the end of the day, most of the MBA fellows and the finance management fellows sitting in the hospital, any corporate hospital you go, the number of doctors and nurses are less than the number of MBA people sitting there. And sometimes even lawyers also sitting there. So they control, now it is an industry. Why I am telling this? Don't consider it as a noble profession here afterwards. It's an industry. You have made that. You have made a double. Alauddin and his booth, you know, once he scratches the lamp, the booth will come. You should give him some work, otherwise he will kill you. Now you have created a booth, health industry, you should give it work, otherwise you will be killed. It has started killing you. So this is the infrastructure manpower problem. And another big, so many committees are there. I don't know. I should go into it. I have my PowerPoint presentation also. Just to start with board committee and after Mudaliar committee, Vinwar committee. So many committees are there. You can go into website and speak on them. But unfortunately, one thing happened in this country. What? Before independence, by board committee, they combined public health and curative medicine.